Around the world, I send you greetings from Malawi. In such days of pandemic of the coronavirus, otherwise called COVID-19, we know that you will have many challenges. However, when I heard that the International Youth Fellowship, the IYF, are hosting this marvelous camp called the 2020 IYF World Camp, I was glad that this could become the light of hope and change. Under the theme of the world connected, I understand that it is a global network program for global youth. The initiative which IYF endeavors about true leaders of tomorrow slogan is based upon a heart. What is a strong heart? I have also learned that it is gained by changing our mindsets, overcoming the challenges, and sharing everything with those who are different from you. I had the precious opportunity to experience the work which they do locally and internationally, and feel that it is right course whereby our today's youth should follow. Here in Malawi, under the Ministry of Forestry and Natural Resources, we regard our youth as a tool for development, as they constitute 60% of the population. The youth are critical for the development of Malawi. The youth are critical for the development of Malawi. And it is crucial that they be engaged for accelerated development of this country. Therefore, I encourage you to join and have a wonderful time with IYF and live your future with changed mindsets. To the IYF team, I congratulate you and thank you for the effort made in coming up with such a program of IYF World Camp, and we'll pray for your success. Thank you very much.
Dan has headlined the largest stages in the world, working with Fortune 500 companies, Super Bowl champions, military leaders, and government rulers who continually seek Dan's thought leadership, counsel, and inspiration. In 2005, Dan was inducted into the National Speakers Hall of Fame. As CEO of the Art of Significance Leadership Development Corporation, Dan has interviewed and hung out with the most celebrated personalities of our time and has appeared on over 500 TV and radio programs, including Oprah and Glenn Beck, and on the cover of Millionaire Magazine.
and welcome to everybody. I understand you had an orientation yesterday and you've been in academy pursuing your passion. That's one of the greatest things that any of us can do. And as you can see, I'm older than all of you probably put together. In fact, I'm so old, I bend over to pull up my socks and I think, what else can I accomplish while I'm way down here? But one of the things that I'm most proud of, which all of you represent, especially you, Sarah, is to commit to being a lifelong learner and always pursuing a new idea and staying fresh and excited about life and hanging around with people who encourage us to dream and become the best version of ourselves. So it's an honor for me to be on this program. Thank you so much. Good morning to everybody, or good whatever, wherever you are.
All right. So we have a couple of questions to ask you. So the first question we have is, how did you become the primary contributor to Chicken Soup for the Soul series?
That's such a great question, Sarah. Let me take you all the way back to when I was 13 years of age. In the American school system, we go by grades, first grade, second grade. This was seventh grade. And I had an English teacher in my school who saw something in me that I didn't see in myself, which is why we're part of this camp, why we're part of this organization, to hang around with people who don't look at us for who we are, but for what we have the potential to become. And she encouraged me to enter this speech essay competition. And I said, no, that's not me. And she kept going and going at me and saying, write a story, be creative, expand, you know, get your passion, creativity, and imagination rolling. And I wrote a story and I won the competition. My family thought it was a great story from this young kid. And we put it on a holiday greeting card and sent it out to family and friends. And then I was in the Reagan White House, President Ronald Reagan, his wife Nancy Reagan had a program called Just Say No. And it was a positive choices program. And she actually asked me, I was called into the Reagan White House to take her Just Say No program to all 50 states and all 10 provinces of Canada. So I spoke to thousands and thousands of teenagers between 1983 and 1989, thousands of schools to millions of teenagers. And I wrote my first book called Getting High, How to Really Do It in 1983 and put that story in that book. And as Chicken Soup for the Soul was being organized in 1992 to 1993, I got a call from Mark Victor Hansen, Jack Canfield, and they thought that was one of the greatest stories they'd ever read. So they put it in the first volume. It's in about three of my other books, and it became the most popular story in the Chicken Soup for the Soul franchise. In the very first book that launched this huge series that sold over 400 million copies worldwide. Let me quickly tell you the story, because it has to do with your curriculum, why any of us are tuned into this Zoom call or participating in this amazing world camp.
Yes, please.
A store owner was tacking a nail in his sign above his store door, which read, "Puppies for Sale." Signs like that have a way of attracting small children, and sure enough, a little boy appears at the store owner's side. He says, "How much are you going to sell the puppies for?" The store owner assured the little boy that they were very, very good dogs, and he didn't expect to let any of them go for anything less than $35 to $50. To that, the little boy reaches in his pocket. He pulls out some change. He counts it for a minute. He looks up at the store owner, and he says, "Well, sir, I have $2.37. Can I look at the little puppies?" The store owner smiles. He says, "Sure, son," and he whistles. Out of the kennel comes Lady, the mama dog, running down the aisle of the store, followed by five little teeny balls of fur, one puppy lagging considerably behind the others. Immediately, the little boy singles out the lagging, limping puppy. He says, "What's wrong with that little dog?" The store owner says, "Oh, we took that dog to the veterinarian. The doctor examined it, discovered it didn't have a hip socket. It would always limp. It would always be slow." To that, the little guy gets excited. He says, "That's the little puppy I want to buy." Store owner says, "Nah, you don't want to buy that little dog. If you really want him, I'll just give him to you." Now the little guy gets ticked off. He gets right in the face of the store. He points his finger and he says, "I don't want you to just give him to me. That little puppy right there is worth this every bit as much as all the other little dogs, and I'll pay full price. In fact, I'll give you $2.37 now, and 50 cents a month until I have him paid for. Storner says, no, you don't want to buy that little dog. He's never going to be able to run and jump and play with you like the other little puppies. In response to that, the little boy reaches down. He pulls up his pant leg to reveal a badly twisted left leg, supported by a steel brace going down each side of his leg. The little physically challenged kid looks up at the store owner and he says, well, sir, I don't run so well myself, and the little puppy will need someone who understands. The greatest lesson we need to learn in gathering together in this world camp, especially in this world pandemic, especially in the unsettling society in which we live, especially here in America right now, what's going to heal ourselves and heal humanity is taking time to understand who we are, and with all due respect, acknowledging that the same God who made you made me too.
Yes, thank you so much.
And therefore, because of the excitement that single story generated, I was invited to continuously contribute my best stories to the Chicken Soup for the Soul series. So I was very involved in the first 12 books, and I have so many of my stories sprinkled through different volumes that you can actually find in some of my own books as well.
Thank you. Yeah, just like that, at the start of the session, I did share your compliments briefly with everyone that you were the primary contributor to Chicken Soup for the for the Soul series. And with all these accomplishments in your life, have you ever failed and got knocked down in your life? And if so, what did you do about it?
Yeah, that's another great question, Sarah. I played American football for 13 years, and one day in practice, the dream ended. We had a tackling drill, practice tackling drill. Coach blew the whistle. Two of us ran into each other full speed. And so the only parts of our bodies that made contact, Lyle's helmet hit into my helmet in a violent head-on collision. My right shoulder was smashed in the cutting edge of my fiberglass pads, and we slammed to the ground. And when Lyle got off of me, my eye drooped. I had loss of speech. I couldn't talk anymore. My right side was paralyzed. My arm dangled helplessly at my side. I talked to it and it wouldn't move. Talk about one moment in time can change our lives forever. Fast forward, I stayed paralyzed for 14 months. I went to 16 of the very, very best doctors in all of North America, and every single one of them told me I would never get any better. Have any of you heard that? And what happens if we believe it? We never get any better. And my life spiraled out of control, and I hit rock bottom, so to speak, which is not rock bottom, which I'll clarify in a minute. But I thought I was rock bottom, and I thought I was depressed. And I use that word thought I was depressed on purpose because I want all of you to understand something. Now that I've recovered, I'm asked three frequent questions. When I'm interviewed on talk shows, whenever I'm interviewed, the three most frequently asked questions are, number one, why did I go to so many different doctors, 16 doctors, 15 of whom said I would never get any better? The answer is I kept going from doctor to doctor until I found one who believed I would get better. It's so important that we focus in on what we believe. And in this pandemic, ask ourselves, are your beliefs deep enough, strong enough, and true enough to equip you, to empower you to respond to rapid change? If not, why not? And if when, why not right now? Second question is, why did I stay paralyzed for so long? Well, I thought I was depressed, when in reality, there's a giant difference between being depressed and being disappointed, a huge difference between being depressed and being discouraged and sad. And there are people in our world, maybe on this call, in our families, in our circles of friends, who've been diagnosed by a physician as having a chemical imbalance, who need medication. And they need non-judgmental friendship and unconditional love from all of us. We need to understand. But in my experience, most people who hit a bump in the road, who are discouraged or disappointed, are not depressed. They just use that word, I'm depressed. No, you're not. When I was paralyzed playing football, I didn't suddenly have a chemical imbalance that required medication. What I needed a dream. I needed a, I needed to fire up and focus in on my purpose and surround myself with positive friends who reminded me, Dan, you cannot quit. It's a league rule. If you get knocked down 7 times, get back up 8. Pain is a signal to grow, not to suffer. Once you learn the lesson the pain is teaching you, the pain goes away. So in life, there's no mistakes, only lessons. You never lose if you always learn. It is not enough to say, I will do my best. We must succeed in doing that which is necessary. You can tell I love quotes. I've written so many that are on posters. I will stop quoting quotes, but you get the message. My friends, we become the average of the 5 people we associate with the most. So if you hang around with 5 broke people, you're going to become the 6th. If you hang around with 5 whining, negative, blaming, complaining people, you're going to become the 6th. When you put a healthy child in the same room with a sick child, most of the time you end up with 2 sick children. Moral to the story, to be disciplined, healthy, and significant, we must be willing to pay any price and travel any distance to associate with extraordinary human beings, even online. I congratulate all of you for joining us and still seeing the value of participating in this World Camp. And as soon as the travel restrictions are eliminated, I look forward to the day where I can travel the world with Sarah and Anna and everyone else and have this face-to-face, heart-to-heart, eye-to-eye, handshake-to-handshake, belly-to-belly, if you will, experience. But until then, we have to gather online and participate. And finally, the answer to why I stayed paralyzed for so long, I was asking the wrong questions. Are you? I was asking the doctors how to get better when I should have been asking myself why. And once we answer why, figuring out the how-to becomes clear and simple. Not easy. Hard is what makes it great. Learning to do hard things is how we become better today than we were yesterday. But it is clear and simple. Again, so if your why is someone else's why, you'll never be resilient. You'll never persevere and get back up and go again. It has to be your why. And I promise you, my friends, whatever age you're in, if you commit to being a lifelong learner and your why is always bigger than your why not, you'll always be able to get back up and go again and share with your friends, as I needed in my time of uncertainty, you can't quit. It's a league rule. You have to get back up and go again.
That's really true. You know, it's really all about the mindset, about what kind of mindset we have. Thank you so much. So what would you say, would you be able to share any words to inspire the youths around the world? What would be any wisdom that you would like to share to the youths all around the world?
You know, I think a smile is a universal language, but so is music. And before we came on this broadcast, we were talking about music. Sarah, you are an amazing singer. I know that. And as we connect with music, it's amazing how your expression on your face changes and you truly become excited about this passion, this why. And so let's just talk for a moment about music. If I asked all of you how many notes are there in music, regardless of what language you speak, regardless of in which country you currently live, most people answer, no matter where I speak in the world, when I ask how many notes are there in music, most say 7. And they count them A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Contraire, mon frère. In the year 1685, a very famous music composer in Western Europe, he decided he wanted more options. And he's the guy that put the black keys on the piano. So if you look at the 88 keys on a piano keyboard, which are the same in every one of our countries, there are 7 white notes and 5 black notes, a total of 12 notes in music. And those 12 notes repeat themselves every 12 notes down that piano keyboard. We call that an octave. What does that have to do with our conversation today? everything, Sarah, and it's the actual answer to your question. Every single song ever written in any language was written with the same 12 notes. Do you know this? The only difference between one song and another song is the order in which those 12 notes fall and the timing and spacing in between the notes. So I should be downstairs in my recording studio at my piano so I could put on a magnificent display from the world of music to make my point. Could play a Rachmaninoff piano concerto using all 88 keys on the keyboard, play a little Wynton Marsalis smooth jazz. I'm a rhythm and blues guitar player. We could play a little Stevie Ray Vaughan, a little B.B. King. We could play a country music ballad, like My Wife Ran Off With My Best Friend and I'm Going to Miss Him Dearly. Just kidding. Regardless of what music we love, every single one of the songs we listen to was written with the same 12 notes. So here's the question, my friends, and it should be the question that we ask ourselves every single day when we wake up, regardless if we're 12 years old, 22 years of age, or 60 like me. What is the difference between a hit songwriter and a lousy songwriter? They have access to the same 12 notes. What's the difference between a great nurse, Miss Sabari, and an average nurse? You have access to the same schooling, the same training. What's the difference between a great banker and a lousy banker? They have access to the same interest rates and the same economy. Where I live here in the mountains of Utah, here in the United States, I drive 45 minutes one way to bank. And never once have I ever asked what the interest rates are on my loans. If money becomes the topic of conversation, it means the presentation is weak and the relationship is non-existent. So the answer is the same to all of these situations. What is the difference between a hit songwriter and a lousy songwriter? Passion, creativity, and imagination. Remember what I said a moment ago? We must be willing to pay any price and travel any distance to associate with extraordinary human beings, even online. The next question then is, what's an extraordinary human being? And in order for us to attract an extraordinary human being into our life, we must first be an extraordinary human being. In the law of attraction, we don't attract who we want, we attract who we are. And an extraordinary human being is someone who triggers more passion, creativity, and imagination in ourselves first, which attracts others into our lives who also feed off of our energy and our vibration. And together, when the water in the lake goes up, all the boats rise together. Together, we feed off one another, even online, as part of this world camp, and actually figure out a way to create change, find the opportunity in change, and create our future. You think about it. Thomas Edison, one of the most famous inventors of all time, he did not invent the electric light bulb by trying to improve the candle. What happens if every single morning we wake up and we think like a hit songwriter? And we realize no matter how many hit songs we've written in the past, no matter how many wonderful friendships we've cultivated, no matter how many times we've gone to class or sought to be that lifelong learner and continue our education, no matter how many wonderful deals we've made if we're in the sales world, today is a brand new day. And we can take the same 12 basic, boring, naked notes of life, whatever we currently understand, and with passion, creativity, and imagination, write another hit song. Let me conclude this answer by sharing one powerful quote in a story, because I'm a storyteller. Please think about this, because it's what makes all of us the same, which is really the answer to your question. Advice. It's not advice, it's changing our mindset and up-leveling the way we see life, especially time. Think about this, my friends. Today, you've never been this old before. And today, you'll never be this young again. So right now matters. and every right now matters, which means no matter what your past has been, you have a spotless future, which means you can't always control what happens, but you can always control what happens next. So my question with an answer in a story form is this: do you believe that one moment in time can change you forever? Remember my football paralysis? One moment in time changed my life forever. And now as I look back, do you realize that that accident clearly is one of the best things that ever happened to me? Don't misunderstand. My accident of being paralyzed isn't one of the best things that ever happened to me, but who I became as a man and what I learned about time and priorities as a result of going through this setback clearly makes it one of the best things that ever happened to me. Adversity is what introduces you to yourself. No one will ever know how strong we are until being strong is our only choice. And because I love quotes, at some point in your life, you're going to hear someone say, is your glass half empty or is your glass half full? If you wonder about that, you've missed the point. It's refillable. Thinking positively or thinking negatively does not fill up the glass. The pouring does. It's easier to act your way into positive thinking than it is to think your way into positive action. It's not the sugar that makes the tea sweet. It's the stirring. It's the process. We have got to continuously engage in this world camp and keep in touch with friends that you meet online, friends you meet in the live events when we reconvene, gathering together all over the world. And as I said, I want to be there with you. We can take each other to the next level if we answer every morning, I believe that today could be a different day. That with passion, creativity, imagination, I can become better today than I was yesterday. So here's my question and the quick story. Do you believe that when you click off this world camp, that you can actually make a decision, take action, and change your stars, change your forever? Do you really believe that one moment in time can change you forever? I do. Proof. I was on the program with Henry Winkler, a very famous actor who starred in a 1970s television sitcom called Happy Days. And the tragedy in this is so many of you on this call, maybe most of you on this Zoom call, don't even know who I'm talking about. You're so young, you don't even know who I'm talking about. That's a tragedy. You need to Google Happy Days. He played the coolest guy who ever lived. And Henry Winkler and I, we finished our speeches. He decides he wants to take some time off and treat himself to a matinee movie. So he slides in through the side exit door of the theater. And as Henry Winkler shuffles himself through the aisle, he finds himself a vacant seat. As Henry Winkler turns to sit down in the chair to look at the movie screen, the little girl sitting right behind him smiles this giant smile, points her finger, and she slowly says, "Fonzie." Henry Winkler immediately snaps into the Fonzie character from Happy Days. "Hey, whoa." And the lady sitting next to the little girl passes out. Henry Winkler milks the moment. "Whoa, I thought this only happened on TV drama. Hey, how cool is this? Whoa." Theater manager comes out, takes care of the woman's needs. She's lying in the aisle, cold pack on her forehead, since she's asked one question. "Why did you pass out?" She said, "My little girl is autistic." And that is the very first word she has ever spoken in her entire life. We have to understand that the universal language that makes us all the same, that brings us together, my advice for all of us on this call in every country, is that time is not on our side. It's clicking as we talk, and we can't ever get it back. We must have a sense of urgency. I have four beautiful children, and they've all become significant in their lives because we raise them with an understanding that the only person you need to be better than is the person you were yesterday. And if you hang around with the five amazing people who also think you're one of the amazing people who trigger more passion, creativity, and imagination, you can accomplish anything you dream. And more importantly, become everything you were born to be, knowing that you're going to make a lousy somebody else.
Wow, Mr. Clark, that was really deep and inspiring. Thank you so much. So now we're going to actually open up the floor to any questions. Yeah, to any questions that anyone may have. So feel free, everyone, to post your questions on the chat, and we will choose any question, and then we'll ask that person to unmute. So everyone, just ask away. So simply post your questions on the chat, please.
And hi, beautiful Maria, I see you on the screen the whole time I've been on the screen. She doesn't even know I'm calling her out.
So now we have the question posted. So Daniel Lim, please unmute yourself and elaborate on your question, please.
Hi, Mr. Clark. Thankful for having you part of this World Camp. And sharing your words of aspiration. You're certainly living your words. And as we were kicking this off, you were introduced as the most interesting man in the world. And so I think just this very brief presentation has given us a really good sense of all the different things that you've done, your experiences. What's left in your life? What other aspirations do you have? Where are you focusing your time and energy today?
That's such a great question, my friend. Thank you. You know, I think it applies to all of us. I don't want to sound self-serving, and please don't think I'm noble by sharing this, but as I started to recover from my paralysis, I was asked to speak, and that's how I became a professional speaker. I parlayed it into a full-time profession. And I've never missed a speech since 1982. I've had flights canceled. I've rented cars, I've driven as long as seven hours one way just to make a speech. And that's not because I'm so noble or a man of such extraordinary commitment and character. Please don't misunderstand me. I've never missed a speech because I know for a fact, and I don't want to get emotional, that there's at least one man and one woman, one young person, female, male, whomever, in every single one of my audiences who is hurting as badly as I was. And when I was hurt, I had so many family members and teammates and caring friends come up. I know they were trying to be empathetic and be there for me, but they would say, I know what you're going through. And I used to think, no, you don't. You don't have a clue. Psychologists remind us that the average person talks between 100 and 200 words a minute. And yet we think between 200 and 400 words a minute. So no one ever knows everything that we think. No one ever knows everything that we feel. No one ever knows everything that we want to say. The author Thoreau was right when he wrote, men lead lives of quiet desperation. So I know how desperate I was for positive vibes and positive people in my life. And that's what's left, is to continuously serve others. You know, in an international audience, there's still an international organization called Alcoholics Anonymous that's the most successful non-medical solution to anyone who's facing or dealing with an addiction. And they have a famous 12-step program. Step number one is admit you have a problem, admit you have a challenge. But anyone who's been involved with Alcoholics Anonymous will tell you that you can actually know, understand, obey, and live by the first 11 steps. But if you don't obey and live by step number 12, you'll start drinking again and fall back into your addiction. And step number 12 is find another addict and help him or her. So in this pandemic, this COVID-19 that's affecting the entire world, what happens is when we start feeling sorry for ourselves or confused about our future and we don't really know what to do, the solution is to serve someone else, to reach down and lift someone else up. And in that process, we both rise we both strengthen. And as cheesy as that might sound, my friend, and yeah, I want to have a number one song. I've had some top five songs, and I still want to have a number one song. I don't think I'm going to write any more books. I've actually written 35 books, so I've been kind of busy. But those are all opportunities for me to try to change the world. But when we can gather together like this in this forum, in this world camp, and have quality individuals like you who are not only participating, but engaged and trying to inspire everyone around you, that's how we're going to heal the world. That's how we're going to bring peace on earth. And I guess when you get a little older, you realize it's really not about money and toys, and it's about experiences and friendships and philosophies of life. So that's kind of on my agenda. And I've been into space. I spent 5 hours looking at the curvature of the earth, gazing into the endless blackness of the universe, pondering eternity and my place in it. And that will change anyone. And I, in that environment, in the sounds of silence, I'm asking myself deeper questions than I'd ever asked. Like, are we more than mere mortal beings living on a small planet for a short season? What's it really all about? And when we landed, what occurred to me is everything we can take with us when we die, I had aboard with me on that aircraft. And in my religious tradition, in my belief system, when we pass away, when we die, I don't believe we lose our memory, and our memory better be that we came to earth and served our fellow men and women. So that everybody leaves us saying, I like me best when I'm with you, I want to see you again. I like me best when I'm with you, I want to see you again. And so just by having you ask me this question, I know a whole lot about you, good brother. And I appreciate you. I look forward to meeting you and anyone else like you face to face someday, because you've really gotten all of us to the heart and soul of why we gather together on this world camp, to figure out how we can come together as one voice to heal the world. So thank you, bro. God bless you.
Thank you. And we hope to see you in person in the future.
I'd love that. I'd love that.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Daniel, and also Mr. Clark. And we have many good questions posted in our group chat as well. And let's go to Zen Su. So next question goes to Zen Su. Please unmute yourself and elaborate on your question, please.
Hello, Mr. Clark.
How are you?
Hi, I'm good. So my question is, what was your process on how you began and started to find other avenues of different passions after your setback and kind of your quest on searching for your why? I'm in the process of, I guess, in the process of trying to find my way out of the setback as well. Just to give you a little brief overview, I've been a musician for about 10, 15 years. And then
I see your piano, bro.
Yes, I know. And I've been studying music, and then, you know, but at the tail end of that, I wasn't able to play with my right hand. It's something called focal dystonia that kind of plagues other musicians as well. So after finding that setback, you know, I've been struggling, trying to find a way to overcome that. And I think the hardest part is just that mindset of breaking out of this kind of rut. So if you would like to share like your advice on these kind of matters and how you were able to kind of break out of your setback from when you first played football. And then now I can see that you're doing music, writing books, and so forth.
Great question. And let me just tie it into your perfect hair. So your hair has not moved since like 2005. And I'm losing my hair right here. And I'm growing it in places I don't even need it. That's not a fair trade-off. My only hope is that the hair in my right ear will grow long enough I can comb it up over the top of my head and fake all of you out. Why do I bring that up? Because what holds us back, good brother, is comparing ourselves to others. And when we do that, we immediately let what we cannot do interfere with what we can do. So let me ask everyone on this call, and you answer to yourself, Are you tall? Actually, let me focus in on beautiful Sarah. Smart, talented, strong, sensitive, a bit sassy Sarah, who's interviewing me. And every single one of you answer the questions. And Sarah, you don't have to answer. I'm just using you as a vocal point. Sarah, are you tall? Don't answer. Are you short?
Nope.
No, don't answer. Everyone needs to answer to yourself. Are you tall or are you short? Are you wide or are you thin? Are you fast or are you slow? Are you smart or are you stupid? Are you pretty or are you pretty ugly? Says who? Compared to what? If we could miraculously transport... If we could miraculously transport Sarah to a deserted island where she has absolutely no access to fashion magazines or those photoshopped Twiggy models that are non-existent, would Sarah not just suddenly love herself for who she is and focus in on what she can do and not even know what she cannot do? Would she not wake up every morning and say, I am woman, hear me roar. I am strong. I am smart. I am confident. As I said before, we've raised 4 children, 1 son, 3 daughters. And as I got better and understood the significance of mindset, the significance of having a positive attitude, positive mental attitude, I wrote what was called the Clark Credo. And stay with me. Visualize a brand new baby boy and then 3 brand new baby girls. And when they came into the world and they eventually found themselves in our crib, in our home, before they would go to sleep, I would grab those little bars of the side of the crib and I would get eye contact and I would repeat to them, to each one of them, one at a time, the Clark Credo. I'm smart, talented, and I never say never. I'm wanted, important, lovable, capable, and I can succeed. I love music. I'm a great athlete, and I'm going to get good grades in school. I never say I can't. I always say I can, I will. If I fall down or get knocked down, I just get back up and go again. If I spill or make a mistake, I clean it up, learn why, and say no big deal. God loves you and you love God. So you always treat others as they want to be treated. So when they're away from you, they always say, I like me best when I'm with you. I want to see you again. And every night I repeated that to each of my 4 children. When they got old enough and started to talk, I would say, who are you? Right before we clicked off the nightlight to go to sleep, who are you? And over time and spaced repetition learning, they repeated back to me. I'm smart, talented, and I never say never. I'm wanted, important, lovable, capable, and I can succeed, blah, blah, blah. Now my son is 34 years old with 2 children, 2 little girls, 4-year-old and 1. When they came into the world, Papa's responsibility was to teach them the Clark Credo. And so when my wife would tend them and we would watch them 2 days a week as my son's wife would work, and I would hold the baby in my arms, you're smart, talented, and you never say never. Oldest daughter, she just gave birth to her first little baby girl on July 16th, a week ago. And while I was in Phoenix holding this newly born baby, I started teaching her the Clark Credo. What's my point? My son's now 34. My oldest daughter's 31. Middle daughter, 29. Youngest daughter, 27. And a famous dancer, big time, musician, songwriters. They're so significant. Youngest daughter, she dances and choreographs with Dua Lipa and Rosalia, won the Video Music Award for best choreography of a music video. And Meghan Trainor and Gwen Stefani and Pharrell Williams, all the biggest name stars. And that's not by coincidence. Because as adults, when we gather together and they come back into town, I'll take that moment and say, who are you? And as adults, they still can quote word verbatim the Clark Credo that they learned as young babies. Here's my point, good friend. When your right hand stopped working, the reason why you're so-called depressed is because you're focusing in on competing against others. When I asked Sarah, are you tall or short, Baba? When I said, are you smart or are you stupid? I don't know if you saw her online. Her face kind of twitched like, really? You asked me if I was stupid? And I used that word on purpose because Einstein said, everybody is a genius. But if you judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree, it will spend its entire life believing it is stupid. Because we're musicians and we're recording artists, we understand the significance of a loop. Do you realize if your right hand does not function in the same way that it needed to do a D minor riff or do a scale or come down the 88 keys or whatever you want to do on a piano? Do you realize because you have that electric piano right now and it could be MIDI capable, tuned into your Pro Tools system right on your computer, whatever you're doing to record, if you're patient and persevere enough and it's you competing against you, do you realize you write a song one note at a time? And because there's only 12 notes, trigger more passion, creativity, and imagination and record one note at a time if your right hand doesn't work. And then loop it. And then combine it. And in my Pro Tools system downstairs, we have so many different channels. Split the channels. Write an entire melody one note at a time. Put them together. Push play. Suddenly, and you're like, holy cow, I wrote that. It's so critically important, brother, that the way we all snap out of any dilemma is to stop comparing ourselves with others. Wow, I'm not as good as he is. I'm not as good as she is. Wow, they're getting along a lot better in this corona crisis than I am. And you start by changing that understanding of the word crisis. That's the first time I've called it a corona crisis since it was announced. Because crisis does not make or break the man or woman. It just reveals the true character within. So there's a way for you to still write hit songs one note at a time. And play that bottom half. Do what you need to do. It's just going to double the time that you spend on one tune. And if you're passionate about it, you do it in the morning when no one's around. You do it in the night when no one's around. That's why I put a recording studio in my home so I could do my spouse thing, do my parenting thing. And as soon as I was finished with those real important responsibilities as a father, as a man, as a husband, then I could go on my time clock, go downstairs when my creative juices kicked in and start writing my songs. And I've written hundreds of songs that are so pathetic, I wouldn't even share them with my own mother. You know, how can I miss you if you won't go away? I think that's a hit. Pretty lame. But in the midst of writing all these songs, I've come up with some hits that were worth recording and that have been enjoyed by a lot of folks around the world. So that was a long answer to your question, but I think that question was a lot deeper than you made it out to be, man, because you're teaching all of us what we need to do to recover in any situation. And I stopped competing against others. And when I started focusing in on what I could do and not let what I cannot do interfere with what I can do, that's when I started to recover. Because it eliminated the time, it eliminated the jealousy, it eliminated the frustration. And I started actually thinking like a basketball player. They never count the shots they miss. In a basketball game, they only count the shots that go in. And there's too many stories of championship games where their star basketball player missed 14 shots in a row, but with 3 seconds left in the game, he shoots that long last shot, that 15th shot that goes in and wins his team the championship. So you never say never. And I hope we'll keep in touch. I hope all of you will like me on Instagram and keep in touch over Facebook and go to my website, danclark.com, especially you, good brother, because we're going to talk music. We're going to talk. I want you to remember. When you're rich and famous, you better remember me. Because when you're in concert, I want front row seats and backstage meet and greet passes. And we have witnesses.
Thank you so much, Mr. Clark. Your message was truly deep and truly inspiring as well. So unfortunately, time's up, so we got to wrap it up here now. Thank you so much for everyone for coming in to join this session. So let's give it up for Mr. Dan Clark. Thank you so much. Yep.
Hello, I am Professor Paul Mavima. I am currently Zimbabwe's Minister of Public Service, Labour and Social Welfare. I want to start by thanking Pastor Oksu Park, the founder of the International Youth Fellowship, for inviting me to this very important occasion where I'll be talking to the youth during the annual youth forum. We are meeting virtually because of the COVID-19 pandemic. This is something that the world did not anticipate at all. It is a stark reminder of the fragility of the world, but also a call for us to always be ready and anticipatory of emergencies. We need to have the resources and the leadership that is necessary in order to deal with emergencies. This time is the COVID-19 pandemic, but there are other emergencies that befall the world, including cyclones, mudslides, tsunamis, earthquakes, and all these most of the time are not anticipated. But it is through good leadership and the marshalling of resources that we can deal with those issues. COVID-19 also reminds us of the need for strategic management of national resources by world authorities. Every resource that we get should go to good use, especially to building social systems like education, health, and safety nets that are strong enough to respond to those emergencies. As leaders of tomorrow, please learn that precious resources should never be allowed to be lost to corruption, and never should they be used for the benefit only of a few people and at the expense of the rest of society. As youth participants, you are on a leadership journey. I want to assure you that you have come to the right place in that leadership journey. As a starting point, I would like to encourage you to heed Pastor Oksu Park's message that you are already free from sin. A lot of people struggle with how they can get out of sin. They don't realize that through the blood of Jesus, they are already free from sin. And if you take that mindset, you will be prepared to lead a virtuous life, a life that guarantees you focused actions, as well as meaningful contributions to your communities, your nation, and to the rest of the world. So I urge you to embrace the Christian values that Pastor Oksu Park teaches and live by those Christian values. Always ask yourselves, what is it that you want to achieve in your life? Define it clearly and use it as a dashboard every day and work towards achieving it. Always place it in front of you so that you can see it as you go through your day. There is nothing that brings more personal fulfillment and happiness than pursuing your life's dreams. An idle life brings misery. And unhappiness. The youths who abandon their dreams live lives of torment and are ridiculed by their peers in the world. So please avoid idle life. Please avoid the ills of drug abuse, addiction to technology, including gaming. And Pastor Oksu Park always talks about this. The hope of the world resides in youths that will have the consciousness to address the world's attendant problems. Youths who understand the potential bad effects of the information world and fast-changing technology, which can expose us to different kinds of vices. Youths who can resist drug and technological addictions, youths who shun the abuse of alcohol, and youths who will tackle climate change, youths who will fight racism, and youths who will shun corruption in high and low places, youths who will advocate for the proper and equitable use of the world's resources. We cannot afford to waste the energy and the zeal that the future leaders have. Most parts of the world are inflicted with disease and poverty. A lot of mothers and infants die unnecessarily every day. Millions of young people are not in school. Inequality is increasing. The world's richest continue to be richer, while the poorest continue to sink in poverty. As tomorrow's leaders, I encourage you to think seriously about how to tackle these issues and find your purpose around meaningfully contributing to their resolution and to improving the world around us. This current forum is an important part of your leadership development. Leadership is all about what you choose to do or not to do. All exemplary leaders that the world has known, the likes of Mandela, Gandhi, Martin Luther King, George Washington, and your own, for example, General Park, who transformed Korea. All these leaders had a set of values which they abided by. The values that you choose to abide by and the habits that you choose to adopt will determine your success. The Christian values that you will be exposed to in this forum are essential in the development of leaders like you. I am very happy that you have chosen to come to this fellowship. Mind education is going to be taught in all the deliberations you will partake. Having the right mind is the foundation of success. Unhelpful thoughts waste time and lead to idleness and mental torment. You should avoid them. Let me end by saying that you should congratulate yourselves for participating in this forum. The cross-fertilization of ideas you will get will enrich you profoundly. I wish you well during the rest of the deliberations, and encourage you to put all the knowledge you will gain to good use. I wish you safety from COVID-19. And may God bless you and enrich you. I thank you.